Good morning, everybody, to this webinar arranged by the Simpla project. I'm very honored and excited to be able to provide you the insights of Resourcefully. This webinar will last approximately 1 hour. The last 20 minutes are reserved for questions and answers. And in the right of your screen, you're able to fill in the questions that you have. And meanwhile, the webinar lasts, it's not possible to interfere. So you'll have to be patient for that. This webinar is about experiences, upscaling, and a future outlook about the city transition in the field of clean mobility and renewable energy, and in more specific terms, how smart charging and vehicle to grid technologies play a role in this urban transition. Now, what are we talking about? We talk about a process which occurs every day, especially in residential and also in working areas. In the morning and in the afternoon, we see a high consume of electricity, of energy, and this is decreasing towards the mid of the day, and then again at the end of the day, beginning of the evening, we see a peak in the demand. This is displayed nicely in this figure, which you can see on the slide. And through the mid of the day, we see another peak, which is visualized by this yellow sun. Thereby, you can see how the energy production in the city, read solar energy, and the energy demand is completely out of phase. This discrepancy is increased by the extra demand of electric vehicles, which are now rapidly entering our society. In most cities, we see a high increase in electric mobility and a high increase in solar renewable energy in the city. Our objective is to avoid the increase of both peaks. This is displayed in the next figure, there you see, by smart and flexible behavior of your energy demand. Production is difficult to steer, and that is something I would like to explain in the next slides. Where do we come from? We come from a society where everything was quite predictable, both demand and generation of electricity. Now, as I said earlier, we see that there is a large-scale introduction of more intermittent, not so good to steer production. And if we would like to have our energy consumed as it is, the production which needs to be adapted is following the shape of the blue production scheme over the day. This is impossible with traditional carbon, nuclear, or gas-fired big energy plants. But we have different solutions. One is to be more flexible in your consumption. Here in the write-up, we have visualized factories or wastewater treatment plants, harbors, which can be partially flexible, but this is only partial. Now, the introduction of the electric vehicle, especially at large scale, can provide a very big advantage. Here it is displayed how at the left up, you see the production, which is flexible, and on the right upside in the red dot, you see the consumption, the uptake of this flexible upcoming power. And both blue graphs below see how you can reduce step by step the amount of traditional read fossil fuel engine electricity production, while our consumption can remain the same but fed with a higher share of clean energy. That is what this the basis of this this webinar. And now I will show you 1 second who we are. Resourcefully is a small company based in Amsterdam, and we have as a mission to support the transition in cities in a line that we are mobile and have energy without building upon locally and globally polluting sources. We work on initiation, acquisition, and management of EU-funded projects to demonstrate what we do. We have developed a innovative dashboard supporting design of streets and neighborhoods to be optimal prepared for large-scale rollout of both renewables and electric mobility. Every 2 years, we organize a high-quality international conference about how the progress is that we've been observing regarding vehicle-to-grid smart charging, infrastructure, grid developments, and how we are step-by-step going towards the direction of realizing this transition, but also looking to the hurdles, the examples that we need, and from technological point of view, social acceptance, finances, and legislation. And at last but not least, we do also invest in a living lab, the Amsterdam Energy Living Lab. We do practical experiments. And I will show that halfway this webinar with a small video, which is now 3.5 years old, where the idea started to push this and to advocate this and to make this grow. Okay.
We zijn hier op de Borneokade, oostelijk havengebied. Op het woonschip liggen 20 zonnepanelen, in totaal 4000 watt piek. Die leveren genoeg energie voor het huishouden. Nou ja, dit is de navelstreng tussen de moederboot en het elektrische voertuig. Waarbij het surplus aan energie overdag wordt overgedragen aan de opslag in het elektrische bakdekkertje. En 's avonds, 's nachts en 's ochtends gebruiken wij weer de opgeslagen energie om televisie te kijken, oven te laten draaien en 's ochtends licht te hebben en dat soort dingen. Je kan het opslaan, je kan het zelf verbruiken en je kan het terug aan het net geven. Als ik wil gaan varen, moet ik de instellingen veranderen. Dan zorgen we dat de batterijen van de boot vol zijn. Maar normaliter is het zoveel mogelijk je eigen energie ook gebruiken. Zo min mogelijk interactie hebben met het netwerk. Je ziet nu dat de state of charge van 6% naar 12% omhoog gegaan is in het afgelopen drie kwartier. En dat komt omdat er nu constant ruim 1000 watt geladen wordt vanuit zonnepanelen, omdat het mooi weer is en er weinig verbruik is. Dit zijn zeg maar de 6 opties die er zijn. Je laat, je ontlaat, dat wil zeggen je consumeert 's avonds van het elektrische voertuig naar het huishouden. Je gebruikt direct de energie. Je kan het netwerk, als daar een surplus aan energie is, voeden met energie. Je kan direct de zonne-energie gebruiken en je kan kopen van het net als je niet genoeg hebt. Of als je wil varen en je hebt meer energie nodig. In maart was ik voor 73% zelfvoorzienend, dankzij de opslag in de elektrische installaties in de bakdekker. En vergeleken met bijvoorbeeld 2013 was het toen 17% zelfvoorzienend.
Ik heb de motor aangedaan.
Ik hoor dat er contact gemaakt is, maar even wachten hoor, Manel. Ja. Nou, we zijn nu aan het varen op de energie geproduceerd op de grote boot. Via het zonne-energie installatie. En Nou, het is een genot om te varen zonder herrie, uitstoot en op je eigen lokaal geproduceerde energie.
Hoe gaan we aanleggen?
We gaan een helftje aanleggen, ja. Nou, elektrisch vervoer is booming. We zien ze overal verschijnen. Ze zijn ook altijd zijn ze vol, de elektrische oplaadpalen. Maar auto's staan wel 85% tot 90% van hun tijd stil te wezen. Staan ze de straat te vullen. En waarvoor zouden we daar niet nuttig gebruik van maken? Van die mobiele accu's die we hebben straks in onze maatschappij. Wat wij nu doen op huishoudniveau is mogelijk op wijkniveau en straks op stadsniveau. Dan heb je een smart city. Als we straks allemaal aan de elektrische auto zijn, en als ik allemaal zeg, dan hebben we het over 30% van de mobiliteit hier. En we gaan allemaal op hetzelfde moment onze auto met prioriteit opladen. Dan kan je een tweede netwerk aanleggen. En het is daarom, en dat kost klauwen met geld, dat is een investering die volledig niet nodig is. En het slim maken van het net door dit soort projecten is veel belangrijker dan het constant groter en breder maken. Zorgen dat je op de juiste momenten de juiste energiestroom aan elkaar knoopt. En ik ben ervan overtuigd dat we dat ook kunnen op stadsniveau en dat het ook uitkomt financieel.
The first small project which I just mentioned and will be shown later is the Amsterdam Vehicle to Grid system. This is a household system. In fact, it's my household system. This has been running from March 2014 onwards and is still running. It is a public-private cooperation between the DSO, the grid operator, Liander, with a clean tech company, Mastervolt, and Resourcefully. You can see on the left part of the slide the houseboat where we have 4,000 watt peak of solar installed, and the experiment was addressing home storage. But instead of executing a home storage project, we choose to store the energy in the yellow small boat beside the houseboat. Now, this energy which is being produced is stored in the batteries. These are lithium-ion batteries installed in the side boats. During the evening, the energy is used, which during the day is generated, by that reducing incredibly the dependence on the energy grid. The energy grid in the Netherlands is highly CO2 intensive. So when you use a big share of that energy, you basically are supporting the CO2 intensive power plants, which is not the objective when you want to install solar, which we did. And the energy autonomy on an annual basis has more than doubled from 34% to over 65%. The amount of exchange with the grid halved almost 45%. And the battery degradation, the quality of the batteries after 3 years is still very acceptable. It's less than 3.5% as we have observed now. This project was also the reason to start a vehicle to grid conference in 2015. That conference led to different other European initiatives, which I will very briefly now pass by. In the first project I would like to show is a neighborhood project funded by the European Commission, Horizon 2020. It's called Parent. And when you look well, you see this is an aerial photograph of Amsterdam. And in the eastern part, we have the Borneo Island. The Borneo Island is the island where we are located. And what we have been doing is to set up a system which makes the inhabitants who have solar panels more aware of their energy production and their energy consumption. Through a submetering device, they can watch real time how much energy is being made, how much is being consumed. And the this device also detects the individual energy consuming devices and compares them to standards to see if they are old, if they are high in consumption, if they could be switched off during the night. And on top of that, some flexibility is also possible. If you produce more energy than you consume, you could store it or make it work, washing dishes, putting it as heat in your boiler, etc., etc., etc. This system is a project which is ongoing, and we see that the behavior of prosumers is changing when this information is being presented. And on an aggregated level and anonymized level, this the technology that we developed here allows local governments to see the energy fluxes through the different times of the year, because in summer it's fully different to compared to winter, but also during the day, and to see how in future the increase of charging stations will or will not cause problems, how we can have this coinciding with PV production in order to design the neighborhoods facilitating energy and mobility of the future. This is a snapshot that we took a week ago. This is from seven prosumers participating. In the upper part, you see the amount of PV energy produced by their solar systems. And in the down part, the consumption is seen. During the third week of March, they produced exactly the same amount as they have been consuming, which is quite interesting. Well, in fact, it was 110%. So the green is production and the purple is consumption. So the green above the purple is injection in the grid. The purple in between the green is the consumption from the grid. So what if we could use the surplus to charge our electric vehicles and to discharge them? These families would be 100%, no, even more, 110% autonomous on their energy performance. This is quite good, especially in the Netherlands, which is quite Nordic and not receiving as much sun as the south of Europe. But this means that over three quarter or almost 80% of the year, we can fulfill our own energy needs. This is in a neighborhood where there's no gas, so the rest of the energy, especially for heat, is coming from city heating, which again is step by step made more CO2 neutral. So the second project is a EU-funded project by the Interreg North Sea Region program. And here we are showcasing and developing six pilots in the field of vehicle-to-grid and smart charging. In different city settings, you can see here to the right a vehicle to home, below that a vehicle to street, vehicle to business, and vehicle to city district. The partners in this project are all from the North Sea region, and we have a small pilot in the UK. It's a vehicle to home in Loughborough. Then scaling one level up, it's the city of Leicester doing a vehicle to business in which the city council itself is participating, larger scale, various vehicles, various PV installations. The same is for Kortrijk, where a waste separation office is being fueled through PV. All EVs are being charged, and an additional stationary storage is increasing the autonomy of this the system. In Oslo, there is a over 100 vehicle charging power parking system operational. It's the Vulcan project. It's one of the biggest in Europe up to date. And during the day, the companies who work in the neighborhood have the right to use this this smart charging station, and in the evening it's for the residents. This also includes a 50 kilowatt hour stationary storage in order to serve all cars and not to have an over-dimensioned grid connection. The two experiments in Amsterdam, one of them is focused on the public charging stations, which are managed by the municipality, trying to increase the charging in the public domain during the day and reduce the offer of the charging stations between 5 o'clock and 8:30 in the afternoon evening. Also with the objective to serve as much electric vehicles as possible with the optimizing under the minimal charging of the local grid. The biggest project is the in this European program is performed by Amsterdam Arena. There, the batteries of 150 electric vehicles are getting a second life. They are being dismantled and installed. This installation is being opened at the end of June, performing all kind of energy services in the stadium, in the arena stadium, which is the soccer stadium of Ajax, but it's also a multi-event center. And the backup, in case there is no more grid, is being facilitated by these batteries. These batteries will also provide balancing services on the national grid, replacing and outphasing carbon fueled plants, which have to roll constantly. And the peaks during events are going to be shaved away, taking care of a smooth flow of energy, and also reducing the connection costs. In the near future, the idea, the initiative is to also provide energy services through V2G. People with their electric vehicle assisting at certain events, of which it's known when arrive and when leave, their vehicles can help picking up high energy peaks by providing energy, and during the low moments of such events, these EVs can be refueled again. Of course, this will be compensated through either parking cost reduction or otherwise. Now, all these different pilots demonstrate that you can increase your independence at different scales, at a household and at a neighborhood. And by smart knowledge facilitated by ICT, this can really make a step in becoming less fossil fuel dependent, less grid dependent, but also the grid can be optimized in order to facilitate this transition, because this electrification of Europe cities is going very fast, and this needs to be done in a smart way. The high variety really aims to show, and also business plans are being rolled out to demonstrate what the potential is. At this moment, four of the pilots are running, two are still in development, and we have different reports. What we found, because in Oslo is number one in amount of electric vehicles, for example. Germany is number one when we talk about renewable energy. But in Amsterdam, you have the highest concentration of charging infrastructure. So each of these provide an element which definitely is needed to have them all grow, because with one element, you still cannot facilitate the whole the transition that we need. You need to have the complete set, and it needs to be incorporated in long-term plans, from having a good harmonization between mobility and energy. Focusing a second into what happens in Amsterdam, this is the amount of energy taken in different neighborhoods, and the type of neighborhood is so much determining the demand of electricity. Well, when we see left up front, you see the taxis. Well, the biggest demand is at 2-3 o'clock in the night. That's when, after a long working day, they come home. But when you look beside that, we see the early pillow charger. The people who go to bed or come home in the evening, put the car in their residential area, and you see between 6 and 7 a boom in the demand from the charging poles. In reverse, beside that, we see it's in Dutch, kantoor, office, the charging in the office, which has a huge peak at 9 o'clock. All EVs arrive, are connected, and then leaving at 6-7 o'clock after work. The visitors of the city of Amsterdam, again, have a similar pattern as the office. And then we have the share cars, and another example of the pillow chargers. Now, the demand of an electric vehicle is very big, because you can charge 4, 11, up to 20,000 watt constantly. And normal households in Amsterdam, in the Netherlands, is has an average connection strength of 1.1. You can, of course, you can do more, but altogether divided over the grid is designed for 1.1 kilowatt, so 1,100 watt. And an EV can really make a big difference in that. And, oops, I'm going wrong. My slide is going in the wrong direction. So, here we see the impact of only 80 electric vehicles on the electricity demand in a neighborhood. This is the electric taxis which were provided by Schiphol and the Amsterdam municipality. And when you see the slight blue line going up between the end of 2015 and the beginning of 2016, they fourfolded the demand of electricity. And this is only 80 vehicles. We are facing heavy demand from the electric mobility side, because 80 vehicles is not very much. So this is something we really, really need to be prepared for. And this is for parking garages, places where you leave your car for a long time, such as a airport or another harbor, places which have loads of vehicles really are facing this, and it becomes to be a citizen problem and a city issue. Now, as I said, Amsterdam has done a pilot by taking 52 charging stations in the center and giving the electric vehicles less energy during the peak hours. And the idea, as I said earlier, was also to provide more energy between 11 in the morning and 5 in the afternoon, less during 5 to 8. But when we see what has happened at these charging stations, this is the first city which is doing this kind of experiments, we see that the energy flow has resulted, and now we look to the right side of this the slide, we see that directly after 8:30, you see a very high peak. All charging points, which are no longer suppressed by the reduced amount of electricity which is given, bounce at a maximum. So the question is this a smart charging or is this not such a smart charging experiment? Well, the answer that came out of that question is, what is the demand of the rest of the neighborhood? What is this, a residential area? Is this a place where the demand goes down at 8:30, because most people, especially in the Netherlands, have been cooking, their ovens are already finished, the televisions are going down, etc., etc., etc. So the impact of such moved energy peak is only to be interpreted well if you know how much has been done in the whole neighborhood. So we need to have a specific neighborhood approach in order to see if it fits in the total energy balance or not. Now, that is to be analyzed together with Amsterdam. There is now an ongoing project to actually do this at neighborhood level. Now, I would like to go 1 second to the Amsterdam Energy Arena, which is the largest pilot in this project, and I also would like to draw your attention to a video that we will display about the Amsterdam Arena.
The Amsterdam Arena, an iconic venue for large-scale events. To ensure an amazing, seamless fan experience, the Amsterdam Arena was looking for a sustainable solution to their energy needs, one that would reduce CO2 emissions and generate value by providing grid services. The Amsterdam Arena and the Mobility House chose the Eaton Nissan X storage building system with a power of 4 megawatts and a storage capacity of 4 megawatt hour. The storage system will make the energy supply of the Amsterdam Arena more efficient, sustainable and reliable through additional backup power, peak shaving during periods of high demand and grid stabilization services. The Eaton Nissan X storage building system stores energy from the grid during low demand periods and supplies sustainable power when there's an outage, replacing diesel generators. It also supports the arena during football matches and concerts when its energy consumption can peak. This significantly reduces the maximum load on the public grid and local distribution. The setup at the stadium includes 9 Eaton bidirectional inverters, 119 racks and 1,160 battery packs using certified Second Life Nissan Leaf battery modules. Each inverter is connected to arrays of battery racks adapted to the system configuration. The Mobility House leverages the energy storage system. They perform frequency regulation by charging or discharging batteries based on grid operator requests, strengthening local grid stability while generating additional value for the Amsterdam Arena. The Amsterdam Arena X storage building's solution efficiently stores and distributes energy where it's needed, ensuring matches and concerts continue uninterrupted, powering the neighborhood when necessary, and protecting the grid while reducing CO2 emissions. The Amsterdam Arena, Nissan, Eaton, and the Mobility House are leading the way, implementing safe, reliable, and sustainable solutions to make stadiums and their neighborhoods more energy efficient. Together, they're building the stadiums of tomorrow, today.